Good afternoon, everyone. And we are really sorry about this little glitch. But as you know, if someone is unwell, then you know you cannot force them to come and talk about actually a very beautiful book, which in English. Hoping that we can have probably another session where he comes along and talks about it. But today's authors are Anuradha Roy and Nayomi Munaweera, who's from Sri Lanka. Anuradha was born in Kolkata, she informs me. So welcome back. And is this your first event here? It's your first event. Okay. And what about you, Nayomi? Have you been to Kolkata before?
This is my first time here in the city.
All right. And she has very sportingly just come on stage and agreed to talk about the topic because her book is also relevant to this issue. So, Anuradha, the book that we're going to discuss, several books, her book is called Sleeping on Jupiter. And she has been nominated she has won the DSC Prize for Fiction 2016 and was nominated for the Man Booker Prize 2015. Sleeping on Jupiter sets the action in a fictional town of Jarmuli, and her protagonist, Nomita, she faces several difficult situations in her life, and then she is adopted. And there is a search for identity and other issues which are explored through the book. So the topic of new homes, old memories is quite relevant to what she has talked about in her book. And she also looks at issues of violence against women, and social issues, social critique, things like that in the, yes. So would you like?
Yes.
Right? So now Nayomi, we would like to introduce Nayomi. She is a Sri Lankan-American writer. Her first novel, Island of a Thousand Mirrors, was shortlisted for the DSC Prize and won the Commonwealth Prize for Asia. Her second novel, What Lies Between Us, came out this year. And her protagonist, whose name is not revealed initially, so I won't reveal it now, goes to America, and her experiences of childhood affect her relationship with maternity and her child, Bodhi. So even her book actually coincidentally is quite appropriate for this topic. Maybe we can just start without further ado. Both your books seem to talk about origin, you know, origin and the movement away from it. So would you say that you have had any experiences or something that you, is this a topic? Why has this topic interested both of you? Anuradha first. You're welcome.
Actually, you're quite right. Most of my books seem to have people losing homes or leaving the places where they have been born and so on. Especially the first book had a lot to do with... Actually, when my first book was finished, what is the book about? And you get completely stuck when somebody says, what is the book about? So I was scratching my head thinking, what is the book about? And my husband looked quite intrigued and thought, and then said to them, the book is about housing problems.
That's interesting.
You immediately lost two readers, because nobody wants to read about housing problems.
Yes.
But as it happens, the book was about a boy who grows up to be a builder's assistant, but never gets a home of his own. And in the second book, there is a woman who leaves her own hometown, which is in the south, to come and settle in a very tiny village in the hills. In the third book, nobody has homes at all.
Yes.
Most of the people are living in hotels because it's set over a 5-day period in a small town, and the rest of the people who live in that town are also clearly displaced and ruthless people. So there is, I don't know why this is the case, why it happened, because I always had a home to live in.
Right.
And so I was getting thrown out and so on. But I've moved around a lot in my life.
Is it, I don't know, you would be better equipped to answer this, but is it the concept of a search, maybe a mental search, emotional or spiritual search, which, you know, maybe you have made it into actual moves in your book, but maybe is that something that appeals to you? Is that appeals to you?
Actually, I think that a sense of, in my case, because my father was a geologist.
Right.
And we kept moving, we were talking about
yesterday.
So I lived in Kolkata till I was 7 years old, and then moved to other places. And my childhood was spent in Kenya. So it's a feeling of never quite belonging anywhere, which in a sense is quite useful. Or it may be even a condition of writing fiction.
It could be.
First of all, I just want to say thank you, all of you, for coming out in the afternoon to hear Anuradha, and not myself, but welcoming me here anyway.
We were going to hear you in any case, but just pre-poned
and
it.
Thank you, Anuradha, for, you know, calling me in. I met Anuradha a year ago in Gaul at the Gaul Festival when she was up for the DSC, and I had the pleasure of sitting, I think, we did a session, and then I was next to her when she won the DSC, which was absolutely thrilling for me too. So it's wonderful to be here a year later with you. And then just to consider the idea of origins, I think what you said about being a writer, the question of home and origins is something that most writers grapple with. And there's this sense of, even if you've grown up in one place all your life, there's a sense of sort of homelessness perhaps, and you're trying to find yourself on the page. I think that most of us work ourselves out on the page. My own story is I was born in Sri Lanka in 73.
Yes.
And when I was 3 years old, we moved to Nigeria.
Right.
And then in 84, when I was 12, we moved from... There was a military coup in Nigeria, and we ended up moving to America.
Right.
So, but my fiction is... My first book, Island of a Thousand Mirrors, is about Sri Lanka. It's about the war in Sri Lanka.
Yes.
And then the second one has a Sri Lankan character. So I think there's always this... grappling with and trying to understand home, what is our
origin,
own belonging, origin, exactly. And I think it's, as a writer, you're sort of always on the outside, and you're trying to figure out where you belong, where your characters belong. And I think it's a good thing for a writer to not quite feel at home, to feel that sort of discrepancy.
Yeah, I'm a poet myself, so I relate to that. Anyone in the audience relates to the sense of displacement and alienation? Yes. Youth, okay, interesting. We'll talk about that. The next thing I'd like to talk about is what is your perspective on migration? You know, in today's world, we are seeing that this is becoming increasingly salient, and there are all kinds of reactions to this globally and everywhere. And it seems to me that there is a fear of otherness which is coming up in various places. So as authors who have either experienced this or fictionalized this and are exploring this maybe in other books in the future also, what do you feel about, issues that migration raises? Anuradha?
I think one of the things that very often when you're writing, when you're asked what is your literary inheritance, who are you reading, who are you drawing from, and it is assumed that you have a single literary inheritance.
Right.
And most people want that literary inheritance of yours to be from where your ethnic place of origin is.
Okay.
In fact, I remember at the session which Naomi and I did together in Gaul, there were quite belligerent people who were saying to her, how can you write about the conflict in Sri Lanka when you don't live in Sri Lanka?
Interesting, yeah.
Which struck me as an absolutely idiotic thing to say, because the whole work of a novelist is to reach new places in your, and create them, both for yourself and
through
your imagination.
Right.
So the question of migration for me, I'm not talking about the situation.
Right.
But in the fictional sense, you are always moving to places, you're making them up.
Right.
Or you are inhabiting a real place very thoroughly.
Yes.
And creating it for you.
Actually, you're raising another important point. It's not just physical migration of groups of people. It is also a sort of damming down of thought, of letting people think differently or about other places, and sort of trying to localize them into maybe notions of nation, or gender, religion, etc. What would you like to say about that?
I think your original question was about migration and how we sort of relate to that. I mean, we're seeing this horrible thing happen in America where, obviously, we are all sort of saddened by this, where immigrants and migrants are seen just as draining and, so, you know, the rhetoric of evil and these evil people coming in and taking our resources is, it's like a very old thing and it's being brought up again. And it's just really sad to watch that happen. I mean, I've lived in America since 84 and I left Sri Lanka. My family left Sri Lanka 40 years ago. So I've been, you know, I live some of my life in Sri Lanka, but it's back and forth. And in either place, I'm seen as an outsider. So in America, I'm considered a Sri Lankan writer. In Sri Lanka, I'm considered a diaspora or American writer. And I think that the outsider, as Anuradha was saying, there's always this suspicion of the outsider, like, do you have the right to tell this story, which is what you're talking about. And again, as you said, the whole project of literature is to be able to make yourself into a character that you have very little in common with or nothing in common with. So my first book was about two women going through the civil war in Sri Lanka. I didn't live through most of those things. My second book is about maternity. I haven't had a baby. I haven't experienced childbirth. But I think that unless we are given the freedom to explore, then we are limited to autobiography or memoir, which I'm not interested in. I'm interested in creating fiction, creating characters that I can inhabit and create empathy for in the reader's mind. So it is a kind of migration to enter a different character who has a completely different
experience from your own.
Exactly.
Both the protagonists of your books, may I mention the name now? You want it to be a spoiler. It's Ganga. So she also migrates, and so does Nomita, who's the initially the child protagonist and is, you know, grows up and she comes back to India to discover herself, in a sense. And Anuradha very interestingly has created this town called Jarmuli, which I asked her, does it have any, you know, any actual specific, you know, location? But she said no. But it seemed to be a temple town, you know, where a lot of people come there and even older people. There's a trio of older ladies who also turn up there and they're part of the story later, who have come there. They are college friends, just old friends who've come there for what seems to be a last holiday for them. And they are also experiencing several losses of identity. That's what I got from it. And they're trying to, you know, think about who they were, who they are. Would you like to talk about that?
Actually, the story of sleeping on Jupiter is set over, it's set for a reason over 18 days in this temple town.
Yes.
And the reason it's set over 18 days is because the Mahabharat war happens over 18 days.
Interesting.
And the things that happen in this town are a kind of modern, you know, a day-to-day battle that everybody fights at a small and personal level in this daily life.
Yes.
And in this temple town, there are basically four sets of four women and four men whose hearts keep crisscrossing.
Yes.
Three of the women are these older women who have come for their first holiday together.
Yes.
And they have the spirit of adventure and joy and slight fear.
Yes.
About each other as well as the whole enterprise.
Yes.
And then there is this girl, Nomita, whom we meet on the train.
Yes.
This old woman.
Yes.
And we can't quite place her because she looks Indian, but she is not really an Indian. And the four men are, there is a priest who is in love with a local tea boy.
Yes, Badal.
Yeah, Badal. And there is a tea seller called Johnny Topol.
Yes.
Who has been, who is completely displaced. We don't know where he's from, and the only signs we get of his origin are the songs he sings.
Yes, yes.
And there is a photographer who's come to assist Moti, and throughout it, there is a sadhu who Reti glimpses in, who never actually speaks, and who is as omnipresent as God, except that he's a very sinister presence.
Right.
So the novel is constructed by the intersections between these people, which lead to, you know, transformations in them.
Yes. And the journey, the next thing we can talk about is the journey, because, you know, both along with migration search, we come to the journey. I like the device of the train that you have used, and I'm sure there are many others that we use. You know, we do encounter the train where they all meet. That's how the novel starts. And there are several things, including Nomita getting off at a platform, which I think was... Yes. I think that would be great, yeah. Just read out that section about the train. And it echoes many things. I'm sure all of us have traveled on a train at some point. And it's very vivid. And it captures that whole sense of, you know, meeting strangers and wondering about them. And the protagonist actually gets off on one platform, which I think is my mother's nightmare, and never gets back on. So she's going to read for us.
This is as she said, when the four of them have met on the train. And the train is going to stop at the station. So when it stops at the station, an hour, perhaps two, had gone by when they stopped at the station. Lights glowed outside. White neon dimmed to a sickly yellow by the train's tinted windows. People surged towards their coach, suitcases and bags in hand. Just outside their window was a tea store. A tattered woman hung around near it, looking for food. She wore a grimy sari petticoat and a too big man's shirt buttoned wrong. Her shapeless rags and matted hair somehow intensified the raw beauty of her face. Ratika wanted immediately to get out of the train and rescue her before she came to harm. The woman was sidling up to the people on the platform, tugging a shirt in passing or nudging an arm, as though she thought that their revulsion at her touch would make them cough up a rupee or two. Everyone sidestepped as she came closer. When she went up to a stocky, thuggish-looking man and put a hand out towards him, wheedling him with a smile, Ratika shut her eyes. She didn't want to look. She would never know anything more about this ragged woman in the murky haze of this platform, what became of her honor. Their train was just a parcel of people rushing through a landscape they had no connection to. Already too many snatches of other people's lives were stored up inside her, the built-up sediments from which bits and pieces floated up at times into her dreams. When she opened her eyes, she had lost sight of the woman, and the girl in the compartment was standing up. She hoisted her backpack onto her shoulder. "Where are you going?" the girl asked her. "Just to look around. Everyone's getting off anyway." The girl gestured at the aisle. "But there's nothing to look at. How long will they stop here? Already so much of the stopping time is over." Vidya peered out. The girl had disappeared into the aisle before Vidya was finished. They saw her reappear a moment or two later on the platform. Separated by window glass and distance, she looked even more appalling. Gauri, who had just finished her evening prayers, put away her beads and opened her eyes. "What a thing to do," she said, "getting off a train. Is she buying food? I'd rather starve than take these risks." Ratika laughed at the improbability of the chubby, rosy-cheeked Gauri either starving or taking risks. "That would be the day. I'm sure you're thinking of dinner already." The girl went towards the stall, jostled by crowds. She was surrounded by men ogling her braided hair and ringed ears and curves outlined in turquoise by her t-shirt. Inside the train, the women were shielded from all the noise and shouting, but they could see her lips move. She looked smaller and slighter among the men. She waved a 50-rupee note over her head. The vendor reached out, took her money, gave her a long look, plucked a packet of bread rolls from his rack and handed it to her, and then a plastic cup of tea. "Why doesn't she come back?" Vidya said. "She's got what she wanted, hasn't she? I should never have let her go. A foreign child." "She was hardly asking your permission," Ratika said. They saw the girl walk past them on the platform with her tea and bread. When she veered left to where the ragged woman had reappeared, they realized she bought the food for her. The girl went up to the woman and held out the packet. The woman didn't notice her, so the girl tapped her elbow. Ratika saw the famished gaze on them of two men idling on the platform. She drew a sharp breath, shook her head to dismiss her sudden sense of foreboding, told herself not to be melodramatic, then saw one of the men sidle closer to the girl. He was leering and saying something to her. She paid him no attention. As if by mistake, still grinning, he brushed an arm against her breasts. The girl stepped backward, and in a single move that appeared to take no more than a second, she thrust the bread at the woman and flung the hot tea in the man's face. She kicked his shin and his crotch as his hands flew to his face. The man stumbled, fell to the platform. All of a sudden, as if watching a silent film, the women in the train saw the food stall outside starting to slide backward. The lamppost by the stall moved 2 feet back, then 3. They saw the girl turning around to see her train moving out of the platform. The girl running towards the train very fast despite her backpack, running as if her life depended on it. The second of the 2 men running after her. The crowds on the platform obliterated them for a moment, then they reappeared. They saw them falling further and further behind, and Gauri let out an anguished cry. What is she going to do? What is she going to do? Pull the chain. We should pull the chain. This was Latika, who jumped out of her seat. They looked above their heads to where the emergency brake pull should have been and saw that it was hanging loose from the wall, its spring broken.
Thank you so much. That was beautiful. And I think most of us can relate to this. It's got a kind of nightmare quality, if you know what I mean, but very important. For the youth who said, remember the initially I said, do you experience displacement, you know? So if one experiences displacement, there's also the question of assimilation which comes in. Do you feel, how do you feel that you can be assimilated, or what do you have to do, which maybe is a condition of youth to try and, you know, find your identity. And I think Nayomi can talk about this a little bit. How much should one change or lose to assimilate? And also for maybe for Anuradha, is memory a barrier or a savior when you're trying to find yourself? So maybe that's the next question.
Yes. I know.
Maybe assimilation first. Yes.
I think what is most important to remember on a panel with me and Anuradha is the importance of women's stories. I think this is something, especially for South Asians, is to be aware that women's stories are still underrepresented. They still have to be explored. Stories of girlhood, stories of being a woman in South Asian context, stories of abuse, rape, the hard stuff, some of the most beautiful stuff, female friendships, sexuality. These are still issues that I think that we haven't explored in the kind of detail that we need to. And I think that's something that I want sort of our audience, our young girls who are aspiring to be writers, to be aware that these are stories that we want. And I hope that in the coming decades, we hear more and more of this. And hopefully, I think you and I are sort of maybe second generation doing that. You know, Anita Desai is here. She, you know, I saw her yesterday at dinner. Yes. It was profound for me because I grew up reading those stories and it was just amazing. I remember the first time I read her and realized that you could read about South Asian women. Yeah. Or you could read about South Asians at all. I remember. Yes. I grew up in outside South Asia, and just the recognition that these stories were important, that they were being told, that they were being read by international audiences. This is all very, very important. And I don't know if this is quite your question, but Anuradha, when I read your book, I was so fascinated that you told these stories about older women. It's something that we don't often in literature or in film, we don't really hear the stories of older women.
And we did discuss this earlier also with her. Yes.
You're absolutely right. And the process when you finish a manuscript, even if your publisher has said he would like to publish it, it goes to referees anyway. And to my surprise, it was quite an interesting cultural thing that when the manuscript went out to referees in the West, most of them said, what are these older women doing in this book? Because, you know, they are completely irrelevant. When the book was reviewed in India, most reviewers said that they loved the older women most. And I remember in Wall, when I was talking about this book, there were older women, because Sri Lanka, of course, is a place where many people from the West retire. So there were women in the audience who were in their 60s, 70s, who said, finally somebody has written about us. Because it's you know, when Hilary Mantel won the Booker, mm-hmm. course, that her books were very good, the ones that won. But the fact is that she had written many very good books before these books.
Yes.
And people pointed out that this time she had picked a male story, Henry VIII and, you know, this guy, Cromwell.
Yes.
And that the whole idea that the woman's story can actually make a book big is not accepted. It's always
yes.
seen as a smaller story. And when you are, I've been asked by a moderator
yes.
Before that why you could, you write about emotions so well that you could have written romances. Which nobody, I'm sure, would ask a male
yes,
writer
yes.
who is also writing.
Yes.
Because the job of a novelist is to probe emotion
yes.
and, you know, thoughts and all kinds of things. But you get asked these
yes.
things.
In fact, I would hope that they've raised very important issues that, you know, giving a voice to women, to South Asian women and South Asians in general, and older women. But I would hope that we would come to a space where we are not just writing about ourselves and for ourselves. Like what we would write or what a writer would write would be relevant across globally and for men and women. So, you know, these questions that you asked, that
sure,
you're a woman
but
and you're writing
I think
this,
that's
I
fair
hope
enough.
This sees
yeah.
at some point, because I'm sure there are many men, younger men in the audience who would also find something relevant. Because if you write something, it's the specific of it could be that the protagonist is a woman. But what you're writing about, I think, is not necessarily about gender all the time. It's about other things, important things. Yes.
I do think it's important to tell the story of women specifically.
Yes.
And
yes.
I hope that male readers do pick up those books.
Yes.
In my experience, I think that male readers are a little scared of that and don't pick up those. But that's just my experience.
Right.
But when you think about the great female characters, Madame Bovary, Lolita,
yes.
these are women written by men. And
yes.
I think that female writers can also write men incredibly well. But there's a statistic like this. If you're a male writer, let me try to get this right. If you're a male writer writing about male characters, the winners of the big prizes, the Booker, the National Book Award, these things, it's men writing about male characters win those prizes about 70% of the time.
All right.
Women writing about women characters win those awards about 1% of the time.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, this, in my opinion, it doesn't have to do with the quality of the writing.
Mm-hmm.
It has to do with what people expect from a book and what they think is an important story.
So let's hope that this particular issue, you know, if we come back a year later, you know, at least it's lessened, or, you know, we would hope that with the presence of authors like this.
In 1 year?
Yes.
I hope so.
Let's be optimistic. All right. The other question was for Anuradha, which is that memory, the role of memory. The characters in her book, in fact, one of them is losing her memory. So,
quite a lot
yes.
about the uncertainty of memory in this book, because what has happened to this child happened to her when she was very little.
Right.
And so when she comes back to this town, of course, she's not even absolutely sure it's the right place. She's not sure what parts of her own story have been constructed in her mind by herself. And I was very struck during the writing of this book by an essay I read by Oliver Sacks,
right.
in which Oliver Sacks had written that he had this memory of a bomb falling in his garden in London during the war. And he would tell people that I saw this bomb falling in the garden during the war and so on, and he wrote about it. And then his brother wrote to him saying, you're completely wrong because you were not in London during the bombing. We were both in boarding school. People told us.
So it was like a false memory.
And yet, because he had heard it so many times, he truly believed that he had,
Seen it. Yes.
He was not lying.
Yes.
And yet, it was a creation of his mind.
Yes.
So this idea of your mind producing its own
truth yes.
was very, was occupying me.
Yes, yes. So one author, one character is, she's actually grappling with this at a medical level. That's what it seemed like. But many of the others are also thinking about their memories and sort of excavating who they were and who they can be. And also what we have is that you know, abuse. The children in both your novels, they have been victims, unfortunately, of abuse of the system, sometimes sexual, economic, or, you know, in the case of her protagonist, it starts with a sort of a purge of the child's family. So would you like to talk about this children of violence that you've talked about? What are the mechanisms they use to survive? Yes, Naomi?
So I have a very similar protagonist in my book to Anuradha's, and who she's sexually abused in her childhood.
Yes.
And her memories, again, are really foggy, and they're very unclear, and you're not really sure what happened. And what I'm trying to get to with that is the fact that when you undergo trauma as a child, your body is in a state of flight or flight. So you actually don't have blood in your brain to produce memories, which is why often young victims of trauma don't quite remember what happened. They're not quite sure who might have aggrieved against them. Mm-hmm. And I think that is something that's very difficult for young women to deal with, because then, especially in the context of our cultures, that trauma is transferred into shame, and it's seen as, if something happened to you, then as a woman, it's your fault. You ask for it, even if you're a child.
Right.
And I think memory is such an interesting thing to play with. It's so fragile. And again, as your story with Oliver Sacks, it's, we don't remember perfectly. And the way that we put together memories is with what people told us or photographs, and it's constructed in a way that we don't quite recognize. And with my character, she sort of moves to America, has a quite a successful life. She's a nurse, and then she gets married and has a child. And in the course of becoming a mother, that's when all the traumatic memories resurface. And I think that's a somewhat, perhaps not common, but it's a possible moment where the ghosts of your past can sort of rise and come to the surface.
Right. You're talking about the troubled relationship between the mother and the child. And Anuradha, interestingly, in your novel, you also have the Nomita, who's a protagonist, who's adopted and taken to Norway. So she experiences some issues with, you know, with fitting in, assimilation, and a relationship with her foster mother that is also a complex one. So would you like to talk about the relationship between motherhood and,
There is a point at which this girl is, after she's come into this town and is looking for her, wherever she is, she's sent her childhood. There is a moment when her foster mother, comes back to her, and she wonders what her foster mother would make of this
child.
And she's suddenly flooded with remorse.
Right.
She started with remorse because when she reached her foster mother, she had just been sent there like a parcel with a
baby. Right, right.
And much as her well-meaning foster mother tried to draw her out, make her feel at home, she was in a state of shock and horror at everything that she herself
had experienced and done,
So she was horrible to the mother.
Yes.
But it's only when she comes away, again that unbelonging perspective, that she realizes that she feels a sense of remorse. And she feels that I have two mothers.
Right.
I have spent my whole life looking for one and not found one.
Right.
And I have one who was right there in front of me, and I just could not believe
it. Yes, and it also relates to, you know, people's relationships with countries, like, or with, suppose many of you may have experienced transitions from maybe other towns to Kolkata, or from one country to the other, and that whole sense of dislocation, and do you immediately fit in or don't fit in? Now, I think we'll just try to sum it up a little bit. Do the new homes that your protagonists and your novels, that the characters move to, do they offer a sanctuary or a rejection? What would you say? Naomi, maybe starting with you.
For my character in the second book, she ends up in a really tragic circumstance.
Yes.
So when the book starts, she's actually in jail for having committed this terrible crime.
Yes.
So for her, it's definitely a rejection.
Right.
I mean, in my own experience as someone that lives between cultures, I think that it's difficult and it's painful, but at the same time, you gain quite a bit. You gain perspective, and you gain an ability to slip between cultures.
Does
and
the otherness of the experience actually make you more sensitive, empathetic, etc., to even people who also have similar experiences?
I mean, in my experience, yes, because when I was writing my first book, I was writing about Sri Lanka, and I was really afraid that because I hadn't grown up there, yes. I would get this sort of backlash of you didn't grow up here and all
right,
of that.
Right.
And yet, I mean, as Anuradha said, there is some of that, and yet the book also has done incredibly well in Sri Lanka. It was published right. there first. So in a way, I've had Sri Lankans say to me, you saw things that we have become completely blind to.
That's fascinating. Like, you have that little bit of outsider perspective, which Anuradha was also talking about, which lets you see the, you know, what is actually happening, rather than being so close to it that you don't realize your own prejudices or what you think is normal.
Yeah, it's always a problem for people when an outsider writes.
Yes.
About it.
Yes.
It's a bigger problem when that outsider has once been an insider.
That's interesting.
The
yeah.
hostility that somebody like Nayomi would have yes. to deal with some people.
Yes. 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 Yes.
It's because people own a thing.
Right.
If you own something, you can criticize it.
Yes.
So. You are not allowed to say horrible things about the place you don't.
That's true. I think in Kolkata we have that. We may criticize it, but if anyone else comes yeah, up, we're all like up in arms.
And the moment I felt the most completely as though, I mean, Kolkata was my home.
Yes, yes.
It's not my home anymore in the sense that I now think of Ramakrishna.
Right,
home,
right.
I feel it's my home.
Right.
And the moment I felt this gap between the two
yes.
was really the moment when I saw on people's faces that if I said anything critical,
yes.
I mean, maybe they grumble all the time about
yes.
the city, but
yes.
if I grumble,
yes.
then the whole demeanor would change. So
yeah.
I realized that now
yeah.
you think of me as an outsider.
That's true. But
so
as a
yes.
But as a writer, you do actually have the right to criticize and complain. And that was our first point, that, you know, there shouldn't be any barriers to your imagination and to the way that you're exploring these very important issues. So thank you so much for this discussion. And now we would just open it up to the audience and let's ask some people. Are there some mics? Yeah, maybe the gentleman right at the back. Right at the back, in the brown with the glasses. Could he have a mic? I think, yes. Yes, please.
Should I start?
Yes.
You've all heard of the hashtag #OscarSoWhite.
Yes.
So, and now things have changed. So maybe, would you like to start a hashtag called #BookerSoMale?
You can take that.
I was really thrilled when Paul Beattie won the Booker just last year, just because a person of color had won, and an American person of color who was talking about racial issues in America. That's tremendous and a huge, huge step for writers of color all over the world. And yeah, sure, yes, hashtag Booker so male. I wouldn't mind that.
Right.
I have to say, yes, thank you for raising that.
And. Please raise your hands again. Maybe if you could pass the mic to the young man in the white t-shirt. Yes. Go ahead.
Good evening and welcome to Kolkata. So my question is that identity crisis is all over in post-colonial writing.
Yes.
And be it psychological or geographical, but sometimes it's becoming very psychological. So in terms of gender, sexuality or abuses that are affecting our personal life. So I'm just curious to know that is it becoming more personal for a writer to write about their own stuff, or is it just, you don't know, autobiographical, but is it personal?
Anuradha.
I think, of course, some part of you obviously goes into anything you write, but the whole construction of fiction is about the transformation that the imagination brings to things you have experienced and observed and thought about generally. So I would not say anyone would be writing fiction if they are interested in writing a memoir or an autobiography. So nothing in my books is directly autobiographical, but many things come from what I've seen or experienced. It may be somebody else's experiences.
Right.
To take that question. So the way that I work is I take memory, research, dream, some of my own experience, things I've overheard, and I put that all in a blender, and then I press chop or puree, and then something will come out that I won't even, I'll be able to tease it out, but you won't. Yeah?
Right. Right. That's interesting. More questions, please. Yes, yeah. The young lady in front, in white. If you could please pass the mic.
Lady,
yes, please
Anuradha,
go ahead. The young lady in white, in front. Just 1 second, yes.
Hello.
Yes.
Welcome to Kolkata. I just wanted to ask that you brought up the topic of women writers being undermined or underestimated. So do you think that has changed in any extent from the, say, the Victorian age, where most of the Victorian writers were writing anonymous?
Interesting. Yeah. Would one of you take it?
Things have not changed from the Victorian age. It would be extremely depressing.
Yes. And
of course it's changed. It's changed a huge amount. I mean, we are public.
Yeah.
Both of us have been published under our own names for one thing.
Yes.
So, definitely. But what Naomi was saying about the statistics is quite true.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if this has been done for Indian journals and so on. But in the West, they have... I can't remember the name of this organization, but there is one which tracks...
It would be interesting if you knew. Yes.
So they track the number of reviews in the press of books by women. And they've consistently seen that more, almost 77% of the books in the media which are reviewed are by men, although the majority of readers of fiction are actually women. So there's a kind of riddle over there about what is going on. Why the readership is so different from the media as well as the press?
Actually, that's a very interesting question. Maybe we should have a session just on this at some point. The next question, the gentleman with the cap at the back. Yes, please, go ahead.
The question is addressed to
You would
like,
need to put on the mic.
The question is addressed to the lady, I mean, Anuradha, I think. Yeah. Now, you professed your presentation with a statement that you lived in tents. That is why and where, unless you were in the deserts of the Middle East.
Actually, my
Thank
father
you.
Was a field geologist. He was a field geologist, and they had to go for six-month-long field seasons. He worked for the Atomic Energy, and they were exploring for, I think, uranium at that time. We didn't know, we were too little. But there were many postings where they were allowed to bring their family. So until my brother and I became old enough to have to go to school, my mother, brother and I would accompany him on these 6 month long things, and therefore we used to live in tents, and each time one place was, it would be completely in the middle of wilderness. And I remember that my mother had to wash clothes in a very fast moving
right.
river in Sikkim. And my brother and I had been stationed by the river to say, shout if she falls in. I don't know what good it would have done. That's what
Anuradha, we are now waiting for your memoir. there was the gentleman in white at the back. And maybe we have two more questions and we'll have to wind up. We'll come back to you. And then maybe, do you want to ask something? Yeah? Maybe you and the lady with the glasses in front. I know lady with the glasses would include everyone in Kolkata, including me, at some point. Just wait. Yes, please go ahead.
Can I listen to you? Yeah.
Yes.
So I have a very candid question to three of you. But I'm located in
yes.
a certain part of the world.
Yes.
And my origin, my ethnicity is something like that. These are the generating as a kind of false barrier in my surrounding.
Right.
Writing is a kind of imagination.
Yes.
I'm just giving one particular reference here.
Mm-hmm.
One noted Bengali writer.
Yes.
Name is Bibhuti Bhushan Banerjee.
Yes.
Who never traveled outside his own country.
Yes.
But he penned down a fantastic adventure story. Name is Chadir Pahar. Here.
Yes.
So when I'm thinking regarding that, I belong to a certain particular part of the world. I can write. Something related other part of the world with the help of my imagination. It is the death of the imagination. How do you think about this?
Maybe Naomi can answer. Being from one part of the world and writing about something completely out of... Yeah, maybe Anuradha. Yes, he did. Mine too, yes. Yes.
It's only that I don't think that being cosmopolitan has anything to do with traveling.
among the most cosmopolitan of writers. Of course, Rabindranath traveled a vast amount, but at that time, the parochialism that you see today in societies across the world, not only in India, was much, much less when people traveled less. There was less migrancy, of all this globalization and so on.
Yes.
And yet it was far less parochial.
Yes.
Rabindranath did not believe in nationalism. He did not believe in national borders.
Yes.
He thought of it as a narrowing of the world.
That's an important point to make, especially today.
Therefore, Vibhuti Bhushan, if he never traveled outside his village, it didn't prevent his mind from being completely cosmopolitan.
Yes.
I mean, I'll just add that I'm not sure if I'm really addressing your question, but I'll just add that I think one of the most brilliant books about America is Lolita. And I think most people that have read Lolita will agree that it is an incredible book about America. And it was written by a Russian, you know, whose first language was not English. And I think those boundaries are really fluid. And you can be, writers come from all over. They can be settled in one place or they can travel the world. It doesn't really affect the imagination.
I think it's one profession which travels well, and maybe even art, because if you remember Van Gogh, and he's in the asylum and he's painting the chair and the view, but it's absolutely brilliant. Now, the young man here, if he can have the mic, or maybe if you have the mic, if you can ask your question first, and you can give the mic to him. Yes, please.
Good afternoon.
Yes.
It's just
not on. If you can just help her put on the mic, please.
Yeah, can you hear me now?
Yes.
All right. Good afternoon. I'm really enjoying it here.
No, we still can't. If you can just give her another mic, please. I think either the volume is low. Yes.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Afternoon. Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Yeah. Big thank you for writing so much and so well, and especially on women. But, you know, one thing I've noticed nowadays, and writing about older women, thank you for that. But what I notice now, that when you write about women, it is causing some men to be very defensive. I don't know why. But there is a sense of defensiveness, even among the very educated. And why that is happening, I am not able to figure. So can you throw any light on that?
Do we have, before they answer, is there anyone in the audience, any male person, reader? Bibliophile who would like to answer that? Anyway.
The question was, is female writing making male readers defensive?
Defensive, yes. Firstly, do you feel that's the case? We don't have enough data, but if any of the gentlemen wish to answer this, they can.
I mean, yes, I think that when the power structure gets questioned, people in power always, you know, you're rocky, and I've heard male writers that are, you know, acquaintances of mine saying, I wish I was a woman, I wish I could write that story. It's much harder getting published as a woman. It's not easy. So I don't think that actually is a valid claim. But I think that gentleman back there had did you have a comment?
Did any of the gentlemen have a comment? Maybe you can pass the mic. Meanwhile, we'll take the question because we have to wrap this up from this gentleman here. Yes.
Yesterday, when I was hearing Anita Desai speak, she said exactly what I felt, which was that the place comes to her first. This is the case with me too. And the place comes to you and possesses you partly because you are, a novel takes anything between 2 to 3 to more years, so you are inhabiting that place. In my case, I tend to make up places. This is partly because I have a very precise idea in my head of the place where these characters are going to produce their story, and that place is very real to me. And yet I don't like to, you know, I've never set even the Ranikhet of the novel. There's a map I drew of Ranikhet in the corridor, but it's says the Rani Khet of this novel.
Right.
Because every place in the fiction is transformed into the fictional place which is inside me.
Right.
The creation of that fictional place, there are many people like Hardy and so on who have always created their places. It's not as though there's no connection. You, as you said, it is set in Ranchi, it's set in my head, it was in that area. So there are specific geographical things like Maika and so on, and yet it's not Ranchi. So
right.
That sense of a place that's entirely my own and entirely
yes.
the novels is really important.
Well, a place of her own, a room of one's own. I think it was Virginia Woolf's birthday today or yesterday. Yeah. So thank you so much. I don't think we have any more time. I'm sorry, but maybe afterwards you can, you know, you can see the authors and, you know, maybe ask them some more questions. Yeah.
Okay.
Okay, this is the last question.
Yeah,
then.
I just want to ask that, unfortunately, I'm not really aware of any of your works. But it's been a very wonderful time here, last 20 minutes.
Yes.
We have been discussing about the diasporic literature.
Right.
But are you just, it's a kind of, being a student of literature, it's like kind of, you know, I just, what I read, that we always write about, you know, like a certain section of the people,
mm-hmm.
The diasporic community, you know, relocating from one city to the other or from one country to the other. But a kind of a sophisticated class, the English-speaking, English-reading sophisticated class. But I think diaspora has been very, very wide. And it
mm-hmm.
comes from various sections and classes of society. So, you know, I would, I do not know whether it's a comment or a question, is that I would rather love to see, you know, the diaspora through various lengths, various angles from various sections of the society. I think that is significantly absent.
Are you a writer?
I write, but I can't call myself a writer. I still don't have a book in print.
Right. So this is, you know, you're right. And I hope that these stories come out. We write the stories that come to us and the stories that obsess us. And that doesn't mean that it's not open for other people to explore whatever they need to explore. These are the stories that we wrote. But, you know, if you're a writer and if that's something you aspire to, very good luck to you, all of you. You know, this is, we don't have ownership of this. This is, literature is something that everyone should own and everyone who is interested should try to generate.
I don't know if when the writer is writing, they sit and think that we're going to write about the diaspora. I mean, maybe some do, but, you know, it's what comes to them at that point. And also this question that you raised, that, you know, the marginalized people, there are many people migrating who don't have a voice. We would hope they have a voice, and they may not be literate also. So let's keep that in mind. They may not be writing in English. They'll probably not be. So this is another very valid discussion, but I think at this point, if there are no more questions, okay, that girl at the back, because that's where I usually sit when I'm at the fest, right at the back. Yes, please.
Hello,
yes.
There's a question I would like to address to both of you. So the question is that when we paint pages with memories, it becomes doubly complicated and it's a problematic issue because of the nature of memories being what it is. So I would like to ask that since memories do not come in a very synchronized order, so how do you intersperse memories with imagination? I mean, according to the plot or according to other facts?
Maybe another?
You know, these questions about how you got an idea or how you wrote a book are very difficult to answer without sounding mystical or pompous because you simply don't know, really. You might be making the bed and something strikes you about your book in progress. So I don't know about Naomi, but I wake up sometimes at night and even jot down in a handwriting, I can't read in the morning. But I need to do this to whatever page it is. And you can't sit and analyze which part of this came from memory or which part came from imagination.
No.
All works together, I suppose.
Exactly what she said. It's very mysterious. So when you ask a writer what they're doing when they're writing, it's quite unusual that we actually know. So it does somewhat sound mystical. Sometimes it feels like we're channeling, like some voices coming through, which might sound ridiculous and crazy to some of you, but it's difficult to pinpoint
what we're doing. And we're not, we don't think, oh, now this is memory, now this is made up. This mm-hmm. It's sort of a flow. Yes. And then you, this is very important, you write it over and over and over again. You don't just write it and there it is. Yeah. I rewrite my novels 20 times. Yeah. So what I start with and what I end up with is about 100% different.
Yeah. Almost entirely thrown out, because during the first half you're just feeling your way around.
Yes.
What do I really want to do with this? And then that gives you the room to know yourself, where you're headed, hopefully.
Yeah.
And then over the number of drafts, he says it's right. So I'm very always astonished. I've heard one or two authors say that they didn't alter a single word. It came to them in a kind of dream, and it. That's not how it happens.
Like Coleridge and Kubla Khan. So on that note, thank you so much. And thank you for, a lovely session. And thank you, audience, for being so participative. And we talked about even the process of writing, which is interesting, I think. Would you like? One question for the lady right in front. Could we have a mic for her, please? We need you to get the mic. She's just coming behind you. Just a second. We would like the lady in front to have a mic, please. Yes? Not that young anymore, but thank you. Yes. Could you just rephrase that? Like, yes?
Once you're displaced,
yes.
Human emotion,
yes.
Expression,
yes.
Feelings.
Yes.
And at the same time,
yes.
Pushing yourself to be very detached. Otherwise, it's kind of a cycle of time, not feeling enough. How do you sort of untie that from your personal experience?
As a writer, how do you detach from these kinds of
I think her question is about how to deal with the depression of displacement. I mean, I work it out in the writing. The writing is both my career, and it's also the place I come to some sort of solace and understanding of my own life and my experience. So the writing itself is sort of my practice.
Right. So I hope that answers you. So thank you so much. We have to wind up now. But thank you for being a brilliant audience, and thank you, authors, and thank you, Malvika, and everyone associated with the Literary Fest here. And hope to see you for some more sessions. Again, thank you so much.
Thank you very much for listening to me.